Hello students, welcome to this video lecture, which is the second part of inverse function theorem, which comes under real analysis of the topic functions of several variable. In my previous video, we already have discussed about the inverse function theorem and also solved or proved the first part of the result. In this part, we are going to take up the second part, and we are going to use the data and the first part of the result to get the second part of the theorem. First, before we start up, we shall just take up what is the statement of the inverse function theorem and what is that we already have proven and what needs to be proved. So here I have written the inverse function theorem statement in a very precise manner, because it was already written elaborately in the first part of the theorem, which we have proved in the previous video. So the statement says that if F is a mapping from E, an open subset of Rn to open subset of Rn to Rn, that means F is a mapping from E to Rn, where E is an open subset of Rn, and F dash of A is invertible. This is the data, and we have to prove that there exist U and V, open sets U and V belonging to Rn, such that F from U to V is invertible. That means we have to show that F is a bijective function, which we already have shown in the first part. And here we'll have to show, in this part we have to show that there is a function G which is a mapping from V to U and which is the inverse of F. G is the inverse of F, and we need to show that G is continuously differentiable. So here in the data, already we have seen in the first part of the result that F is a continuously differentiable function. We also have to show that here if G is the inverse of F, and G is also continuously differentiable function. This is what we need to show. Now what we will do is we shall make use of the first part of the result and then look at how we are going to get the proof of this theorem. So let us start the proof of this part. What we will do is we shall take let y belongs to V and y plus k belongs to V, where this k is very small. So y and y plus k are very neighboring points of the set V. Then see, if y belongs to V, y plus k belongs to V, then corresponding there should be some x belongs to U and x plus h belongs to U, such that y is equal to f of x and y plus k is equal to f of x plus h. So then for x belongs to U, there exist x plus h belongs to U such that y is equal to f of x and y plus k is equal to f of x plus h. So already we have this result from our first part. So in the first part we have proven this. So I think that was the equation from 5. So from 5 we have modulus of phi of x1 minus phi of x2 is less than half of mod x1 minus x2, from where we proved this with the help of contraction. So contraction principle, using this what we can do now is modulus of phi of x plus h minus phi of x. How can we write this? This will be less than or equal to half of mod h. Let us call this as equation 7. Also, we have from our first part, from equation 3, what do we have? Phi of x is x plus a inverse of y minus f of x. A inverse of y minus f of x. So with the help of this definition of phi of x, we can get what is phi of x plus h minus phi of x. So how we are going to do that? So therefore, phi of x plus h minus phi of x is equal to x plus h plus a inverse in the definition of equation 3. So we are going to replace x by x plus h, and phi of x we are going to subtract from phi of x plus h. So x plus h plus a inverse into y minus f of x plus h. So this is phi of x plus h. So now what we have to do is we have to get phi of x minus h minus phi of x plus h we have written. We have to write phi of x, which we already know from equation 3. So which is, since minus is there outside, I can write it as x minus a inverse into y minus f of x. So that after simplification gives you h plus a inverse of f of x minus f of x plus h. So which is in turn equal to h plus a inverse of, we have defined from our previous slide, we have defined y is equal to f of x, therefore y, for y belongs to v and y plus k belongs to v, there exists x and x plus h belongs to u such that y is equal to f of x and y plus k is equal to f of x plus h. So we can just substitute that y minus k. So that gives you h minus a inverse k. So also from 6, modulus of h minus a inverse k is less than or equal to half of mod h. So from where we, from equation 6, from equation 7 this is. So here only just now we have written our 7. So from equation 7, phi of x plus h minus modulus of phi of x plus h minus phi of x is less than or equal to half of h, which we had written using the equation 5, which was because of contraction principle theorem. So now what I have done is I have just substituted phi of x plus h minus phi of x in equation 7. Therefore, you are going to get h minus a in modulus of h minus a inverse k is less than or equal to half mod h. So that implies half mod h or half mod h is greater than or equal to mod h minus modulus of a inverse into k. Okay. So you can just reverse this, or that means a less than or equal to b means b is greater than a. So that this is what has been written. So that means you can even write it as half nor h is greater than or equal to, this is minus half, because you can see that both the sides we have norm h. So bring norm h to one side, so that you are going to get minus half norm h is greater than or equal to minus modulus of a inverse k, or you can say norm a inverse k. So which in turn implies norm a inverse k is greater than or equal to half greater than or equal to half norm h. So that implies norm h is less than or equal to 2 times norm a inverse k, or this is once again is less than or equal to 2 times of norm A inverse into norm K, which again implies norm H is less than or equal to 2 times norm A inverse. From equation 1, we know that it is 1 by 2 lambda into norm K. So, that gives you norm H is less than or equal to lambda inverse into norm K. This can be written as 1 by norm K is less than or equal to lambda inverse by norm H. Let us call this as equation 9. So now what we will do is, there is a lemma, we shall just try to use that lemma. Let us use a lemma which says that if omega denotes all linear operators from Rn to Rn, that means omega represents L of Rn, all linear operators from Rn to Rn, such that all are invertible. That means n artha omega dalirudu ella omega dalliro ella linear operators invertible agidave anta. Then a subset of omega comma b subset of L of Rn. A is already in omega, which is in which A is a linear operator which is already in omega, which is invertible, and B, let B be a simple linear operator from Rn to Rn. Then if norm B minus A into A inverse, norm A inverse is less than 1, then B also belongs to omega. That means B also is a invertible linear operator. So this lemma helps us to prove this part of the inverse function theorem. So let us now use this lemma. Before that, we shall just make use of some interpretation so that we can start using this lemma. Now, one and two imply, we already have these equations 1 and 2 from our first video. 1 and 2 imply norm f dash of x minus a into norm a inverse is less than lambda into 1 by 2 lambda, which is equal to 1 by 2. So now you can see that this is almost like this. You can see that norm B minus A into norm A inverse is less than half. So this is less than half, is less than 1 also. Therefore, this is less than 1. Hence, what I can do is I can start using this lemma. So, what we can do using the above lemma, what we can say, F inverse, F dash of X whole inverse
is equal to t. Since why is this? Because f dash of x is invertible.
ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಬಂದಿದೆ ಇದು?
ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಲೆಮ್ಮಾ ವಿಚ್ ಸೇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಇಫ್ ನಾರ್ಮ್ ಬಿ ಮೈನಸ್ ಎ ಇಂಟು ನಾರ್ಮ್ ಎ ಇನ್ವರ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಲೆಸ್ ದ್ಯಾನ್ ಒನ್, ದೆನ್ ಬಿ ಬಿಲಾಂಗ್ಸ್ ಟು ಒಮೇಗಾ ವಿಚ್ ಕಂಟೈನ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ ದಿ ಲೀನಿಯರ್ ಆಪರೇಟರ್ಸ್, ಇನ್ವರ್ಟಿಬಲ್ ಲೀನಿಯರ್ ಆಪರೇಟರ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಆರ್ ಎನ್ ಟು ಆರ್ ಎನ್. ಥೇರ್ಫೋರ್ ಎಫ್ ಡ್ಯಾಶ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ವರ್ಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಈಕ್ವಲ್ ಟು ಟಿ. ಸೊ ನೌ since g of y plus k minus g of y minus tk is equal to h minus tk, this is because g of y plus k is nothing but f of x plus h minus f of x, that gives you g of y plus k gives you x plus h minus g of y gives you x plus h minus x, that gives you h. Okay, that gives you h minus tk as it is. And now if I take t minus t outside, what is that we are going to get? K minus t inverse of h. But what is t inverse? So that is equal to minus t times k means f of x plus h minus f of x. From where you will get this? Because f of x plus h is y plus k and f of x is y. So y plus k minus y gives back k to you. So this is your k minus, what is t inverse? T inverse is nothing but f dash of x into h. So just now we have got t is equal to f dash of x. Therefore t inverse comes out to be as f dash of x. So now what we do is we will take norm on both sides. Taking norm on both sides. What do I get? Norm g of y plus k minus g of y minus tk divided by norm k is less than or equal to, okay, what we get. So what I am doing is I am taking norm on both sides and dividing both sides by norm k. So now what you will get? Norm t by norm k into norm f of x plus h minus f of x minus f dash of x into h. For this what I will do is I will divide by norm h and multiply by norm h. So look at that. Now what we have done, we have not only taking the norm on both sides, we have divided both the sides by norm k, and then on the right hand side for this particular term we have multiplied and divided by norm h. Now this implies there is no change here. Norm g of y plus k minus g of y minus tk divided by norm k. And now look at this. From the equation 9 we can write, see, we have norm h by k here. You can see we have norm h by So norm h by k is there from equation 9. We can write it as less than or equal to, because norm h by k will be less than or equal to lambda inverse, which is 1 by lambda. So this becomes norm t by lambda into a norm f of x plus h minus f of x minus f dash of x into h divided by norm h. So how did we get this? We have used equation 9. This is using 9. So now we can just take, we know that as k tends to 0, h also tends to 0. Therefore, limit k tending to 0 of norm g of y plus k minus g of y minus tk divided by norm k will be less than or equal to norm t by lambda limit h tending to 0 norm f of x plus h minus f of x minus f dash of x into h divided by norm h. And you can see here on the right hand side, just this part if you look at, you can see that this term f norm limit h tending to 0 f of x plus h minus, if you separate it into two parts, so here this one and this one separately. Okay, suppose if you do this, you can see that the first part is nothing but f dash of x, and second part there is nothing to do with limit h tending to 0 because norm h by h will vanish and you will have f dash of x. So first term is nothing but f dash of x, second term is negative of f dash of x. So when h tends to 0, RHS tends to 0. So we can just write that. So this simply implies limit k tending to 0 norm of g of y plus k minus g of y minus tk divided by norm k is equal to 0. This is because since RHS tends to 0 as h tends to 0. So what is this now? You can see that from the definition of our linear differential operator, we know that left hand side is nothing but the differentiation of g, and is, which is, will be equal to t. So which implies which implies g is differentiable and what will be g dash of y? G dash of y will be equal to t. That is g dash of y is equal to t, which is nothing but f dash of x whole inverse. T is nothing but the inverse of f dash of x. And what is this gives you? See, we have g is differentiable. So g is differentiable, we know that every differentiable function is continuous. So with the help of that, we can say that g is continuous. Since g is differentiable, g is continuous. So from u to omega. And we also know that inversion of continuous mapping is continuous. We also know that inversion of continuous mapping is continuous. So what does that imply? That implies g dash of y is equal to t is also continuous. So g is continuous, g dash is also continuous, which means g dash is continuously differentiable. which implies G is continuously differentiable. G is continuous. G dash is also continuous. Therefore, G dash G is continuously differentiable. And this is what we wanted to show. So, this is where the proof of the theorem ends. So, if the inverse function theorem is asked, then we have to prove whatever we have proved in the previous video, part 1 of inverse function theorem and part 2 of inverse function theorem together gives you the proof of inverse function theorem. Thank you.